Thanks very much, John. And it's obviously, and it is a great honour and a great privilege for me to be invited, first of all, to share a little bit of my philosophy, I suppose, about the future. Coming as I do from a very remote little part of Ireland, Banshee, as John said, but a place, I suppose, where I learned a lot about life when I was a young boy because of the influence of Canon Hayes, who was the founder of Moynton na Tíre. I was actually down there on Saturday at the launch of another initiative by Moynton na Tíre. And I suppose it's just to put that into context that that had a major influence in how I approach life and I suppose the things that I believed were important and are important and will be important in terms of now and the future. But I suppose I'd be saying at the very beginning that the most important thing of all is to live in the present. It's the only little bit that you're in control of, actually, believe it or not. It's just what's happening now rather than maybe great dreams of what might happen in the future. So I think it is very important when we think about the future that we are very conscious that the most important thing of all is to live it as it comes at the time, the present, that wonderful thing, the present. I'm a great fan of Mickey Hart, the Tyrone manager, and it's not about his football and his football philosophy, but it's about his life philosophy. For many years I was fascinated by the way he approached life and how he connected it into sport. And anybody who was, I think, lucky enough to see him being interviewed a few weeks ago, 2 days after his daughter was murdered, would have been very impressed with how he coped with it. And I just want to share a couple of things that he actually said that evening at probably the most difficult time in his life. Himself and his two sons, and he came and faced the media. But what he said is so important just to remember. He said, you know, we all know many families and people who have gone through a similar experience. And he said, we always had sympathy for them. But I never, ever knew what it was like until I experienced it myself these last 2 days. I think that was very, very powerful. We know lots and we hear lots and we have empathy and sympathy, but we don't know what it's like until it happens. And it's very important to remember that because we became, and we are, very judgmental about people in terms of, you know, even today around the government, I heard some of the debate that was going on in the Dáil, very judgmental, without not ever having the full story. And that's what my life in prison was always about as well, because most people hadn't got the full story. There's two little things I want to share with you because I think they're fantastic in terms of the way forward. This particular one that I'm going to refer to now was written about 600 years before Christ. And you know, people might think that, sure, God, what would they know 600 years before Christ? Because we became a bit like that. We are the most educated race ever now, and Papa, you know, and we dismissed a lot of the old stuff because, so what would they have known? But somebody wrote this, a Chinese guy, way back 600 years before Christ. And I suppose it's a great little starting position for me anyway, and for people looking to the future and leading people in the future, and how a bit of philosophy around how it should be done. And it goes like this. It said, go to the people, live with them, learn from them. Love them. Start with what they know, build with what they have, but with the best leaders, when the work is done, the task accomplished, the people will say, we've done this ourselves. I think that's fantastic, because that famous man down in Banshee that I mentioned a few minutes ago, Canon Hayes, is attributed to have said this. And I don't know whether he did or not, but they say he did. And maybe others said it as well, but this little comment is attributed to him, and he said, there's two types of people in the world. There's those who do the work and those who take the credit. And there's far more competition within the latter group. And it would be worth reflecting on that as well. Taking credit. It was my idea. It was I achieved it. And I must go back once again to Mickey Hart, because after they winning their third All-Ireland, the commentator stuck an old microphone in his mouth, almost in his face, and said, listen, you must be the greatest football strategist ever. Three All-Irelands with a county that never won an All-Ireland previously. Ara, he said, will you go away? No, rubbish, he said. No, he said, I get a hand of cards every year, the team, and that's the hand of cards I've been dealt, and I make the best of it. And he said, we operate as a family, building on what we have and growing and nurturing. But the last little point that I wanted to share with you around this whole thing of credit was, he said to him, in his final comment as he was going to leave him go, he said to him, you never seem to get excited, or you never seem to get any sort of, you know, overcome with any emotions when the match is on or after the match, or do you enjoy it at all? And he said, oh God, I do. I enjoy it immensely, he said. But he said, what I get my enjoyment out is observing other people, the people of Tyrone, enjoying the success of the team. Amazing. There's generosity. I get my enjoyment out of observing others enjoying themselves. Real, I would say, service, giving. There's no perfect era. There was never a perfect era, and there ain't one, and I'm certain of this, there never will be one. Why? Because wherever human beings are, I don't believe we could ever have that perfect era. So in the past, there were some wonderful things in the old era, great things, and there were some terrible things. And currently, we have some wonderful things, believe it or not, because we forget some of the wonderful things we have. Like travel. Fantastic. You know, we're talking about immigration again. But my God, the difference this time with immigration and the last time. People went and never came back simply because they couldn't. Technology, how wonderful technology is and what it has done to educate us and to inform us and to help us. And many other things as well. But I suppose the area I want to first focus on for tonight and just, you know, focusing on it, I suppose, around people. What we lost in the recent past was that emphasis on people, the needs of people, respect. I said we've got to go back to, in the future I would be arguing anyway that we need values again. We had values in the past and I don't know that we live up to them. But in the future I hope we have some basic values that we will live up to as being fundamental to the way we're going to develop our society. And it's going to be, I would suggest, going to be based on the needs of people rather than systems and structures and individuals and authority and whatever else. But it's about people. And I start off very basic stuff in relation to what are, as Jean Vanier, that wonderful Frenchman, said, was dedicated his whole life to working with people with serious disabilities, said that the human beings, or man's most primal cry, is what? Is it to be loved. And what does that mean? To be accepted as I am, warts and all. And that's where I believe we should start for the future, is respecting individual people and treating everybody with respect. And we can't do that if we ignore the needs of very vulnerable people, like the elderly sometimes, like the poor, like the sick, like the young. And so, There's no demonstration or example of showing respect if we leave sick people for days on old trolleys. That's disrespectful. And it sends out a message that people ain't important. And I did argue during the old Celtic Tiger era that there were more important things than the economy. And I still say that. And those important things are people. The needs of people. Canon Hayes had an old philosophy which was based on caring and sharing. Caring for one another and sharing. And I would argue again and put forward that that is another foundation stone for the future. I would say to political parties, stop telling us what we should be doing. Listen to what we want and listen to where we're at. Listening. They're already coming up with solutions. It's hard to find solutions when they don't know where the people are at. And I detect at the moment that the people are absolutely frustrated with that whole amount of emphasis and obsession that is the economy and money and banks. And a lot of the stuff that I'm talking about costs nothing. It's about treating people with basic respect, honesty, openness, truthfulness, telling the truth. Surely we're never going to go through another era where we misinform or fail to inform the people of what the reality is. Common people. I've mentioned already a few times publicly about that huge system of spinning, public relations, and spinning stuff out to try to get across a part of a story and try to suppress the bits that are unpopular. And therefore we don't get the full story. And I do, and I did say, and I continue to say in the future, there's no need to spin the truth. It is self-explanatory. You don't have to spin it, just tell it. Openness as well, transparency. Believe it or not, we are a very secret society in reality. There's a lot of stuff going on in our name that we know nothing about. And I'll just give the last example of a few weeks around Christmas, when the High Court were asked to make a very serious decision around the funding of a bank, and it was done in camera. And who's going to pay it? You are. So if you pay, you're surely entitled to know. So secrecy and not an openness, transparency. And I'm not talking about opening offices. The government in the recent past, in the last decade or so, or a little longer, said they were going to have open government, and they opened the offices on a Saturday. Seriously, that is actually happened. That's not openness and transparency. Or a response to a question in the Dáil when some information wasn't provided. A comment a couple of weeks later, you didn't ask the right question. That's not openness and transparency. And then the final thing, I suppose, is just about what human beings need. We must never again, I hope anyway, this will be my old dream and vision and hope above all things, is we must never again get obsessed with how important materialism is. Because we did. We were conditioned to believe that materialism fulfilled all our human needs. Big was better. The bigger, the better. It was amazing. Even the houses we built. It was just, this perception was driven into us that bigness was greatness. And so we became almost obsessed. And if I do have to go back once again to Canon Hayes, because I think it's very appropriate, and while we're looking to the future, I think we can't forget the past. He predicted 70 years ago that if we got obsessed with materialism, we'd create a society of what? Of competition, of jealousy, of greed. And we did. Enough. What is enough? I don't know if anybody in Northern Ireland know the meaning of enough. And I'm afraid that is where a lot of it begins and ends. It's us, all of us, equally saying, we're very blessed to have what we have in some. John said, I broke my old ankle a couple of months ago. I'm telling you, I never appreciated my old ankles until 2 months ago. Honestly. I took them for granted. I will never take them for granted again. And that's what I think. So what sort of things are important? Listen to me. I say to students when I go to schools every day, I say, listen, there's only two measurements for you, really, for life. The first measurement is ask yourself, are you healthy? Honestly, are you healthy? And if you can say yes, you're sure you're blessed. And the second one is nearly equally obvious, but we never hardly ever think about it, and that's happiness. Just contentment. Happiness. And John Quinn chairing it, and he'll recall this, I'm sure, Charles Handy, down in Ennis many, many, many years ago. I've read a lot of stuff that Charles Handy wrote over the years, because he wrote a lot about getting balance into your life, and it's still very relevant today. But John was chairing it, he was at a conference in Ennis, and he was asked, listen, you write a lot about balance and happiness. What is happiness? Could you describe happiness for us? And he said, well, I can't myself personally. But he said the Chinese, once again, studied happiness. And the Chinese came up with this particular definition of happiness. And I just want to share it with you this evening, because I think it is so meaningful for the future, First element, he said, three elements. First element of happiness was to have something in life to work for. So it doesn't matter how young or old you are, if you have something in life to work for. And everybody here knows what that feeling is like. It could be the workplace, but it might be at home as well. It could be in your community. It could be anything in life. But you know that feeling. It means that you're important. It means that you're occupied. It means that you're fulfilled. Something in life to work for. And then the second part, he said, was to have something to dream for. And I hope it's not winning the lotto now. Imagine if you won the lotto 3 or 4 years ago and you asked a financial whiz kid what to do with it and he'd have told you to invest it in Anglo-Irish shares. So it's not the old lotto, but a dream. And again, many of you have experienced that, I'm sure, where you had a dream and you achieved your dream or you fulfilled it. Might be for yourself, or preferably it might be a dream about others or for a community or whatever. But that dream, something up there that we haven't got there yet, and you strive and work to achieve it. That dream. Mickey Hart, I'm sure, when he took over as manager at Tyrone, I bet he dreamt that someday we'll bring Sam Maguire over the border back to Tyrone for the first time. Imagine the feeling when he achieved it. God. Then the third element, which is absolutely vital, I think, and is obvious, and it is the third element, Handy said, the Chinese discovered was to have somebody in life to love. What does that mean? Just to have somebody to share life with. Because without that connection with other people, we're all lost. It's about connecting with people. As Canon Hayes said, it's about caring and sharing for one another, keeping in contact. The sharing of all the things I'd say in the future that we need to share, besides, you know, the most important thing of all is to share our time. Sharing our time. Giving our time to others. Not running into the local shop, meeting a neighbour and saying, I haven't time to talk to you. I'd love to talk to you, but I don't have the time. So what are you doing? Rushing around, going nowhere. And so the future is about connecting with people. It's about treating people, I believe, with respect. It's about getting rid of all that old class distinction stuff that we have. The old proclamation said, you know, and claimed that we should cherish all our children equally. There's many interpretations of that, but fundamentally what I believe, took out of it, I believe from it, is that we should cherish our children equally. We should give them all an opportunity to grow to their potential. That's a great challenge for the future, and it is the answer to many of our problems if we could meet that challenge to make sure that children can grow to their potential. And what that will require is those who have giving to some of it to those who have not. I'm finishing off on the latest statistics that came out only yesterday around social justice, and it summarises maybe today, the 1st of February, the start of the new general election. It summarises where we went in the past and the challenge for the future. 10% of the top earners, or the top people, the rich people in Ireland, own 25% of the wealth of the country, and the bottom 10% of the people own 2%. So the top 10% is 25%, and the bottom 10% have 2%. And we are running at towards a reality shortly that up to 800,000 young people, children and families, will be in the poverty trap. If that's not a challenge for the future, nothing is. We don't need often as much as we think we need in materialistic terms. What we need is some basic human fulfillment. And most of that, in my view, will be got, the enjoyment and the satisfaction will be got by caring and sharing with others. If you care and share about others, the day will come when they will care and share about you.